We filmed this episode quite a while ago, and as we were digging into the production, our fellow YouTuber Cleo Abram posted one on the same subject, which is great, and you should watch it. But it turns out, her adventure to the center of the planet turned out to be quite different from our own, which I think is very interesting. So, we decided to use the video we had already shot and tell our own story. As a kid, did you, like me, have that dream of just digging a hole at the beach and then making it all the way to the center of the Earth? My friend Jeff dug a hole in his backyard until he hit the water table. It was a well. But as always happens, our dreams get cut short long before you reach bedrock. But over the years, people have kept at it. Scientists and engineers all over the world have tried digging as deep as possible, hoping to learn more about the inside of our planet. Despite their best efforts and decades of drilling, these projects have barely scratched the surface. Turns out, nearly 6,400 kilometers of planet might be a bit too much of a challenge for us right now. But what if we could do it? What if we had the tech, like in the terrible/brilliant 2000s film The Core, to blast all the way to the middle? What would we experience along the way? I'm gonna take you on a journey to the center of the Earth. On the way, we will discover huge fields of diamonds, solid rock flowing almost like a liquid, and a mysterious inner core that scientists are only just beginning to understand. But you might want to grab a glass of water, because it's gonna get hot. The first stage of our journey takes us through the crust. And if your objective is to get through the top layer of the planet as fast as possible, you probably should start in maybe an unexpected place. The ocean. Oceanic crust is the thinnest kind on Earth, maxing out at about 10 kilometers in depth, made pretty much entirely out of basaltic igneous rock. In the 1960s, the US chose this seemingly easy route with their Project MOHOL, aiming to get samples from the oceanic crust off the coast of Guadalupe, Mexico. The problem is, before you even get to that igneous rock, you have several kilometers of ocean to deal with. Geologists have described drilling into the ocean floor through the ocean as being like drilling through the ground from a helicopter. It was difficult and expensive, and Project MOHOL only managed to dig a hole about 180 meters deep before the money and everyone's patience ran out. Even with today's technology, honed by decades of deep ocean drilling, researchers have only penetrated a little more than 2 kilometers below the sea floor, less than a third of the distance needed to make it through the crust. Which leaves us with starting out our hole on dry land, on a nice, stable bit of continental crust. The kicker here is that the crust is a lot thicker than the stuff beneath the oceans, and we could be facing up to 70 kilometers of rock on our crustal journey alone. And as we delve deeper into these rocks, the conditions make our project a little tricky. Temperature is increased by 25 degrees Celsius for every kilometer we descend toward the planet's superheated interior. Thanks to the weight of the rocks above, the pressure increases by 1 atmosphere for every 3 meters down. Ultimately, this is what has stalled all of our real-world attempts to dig to the center of the Earth, like the Kola Superdeep Borehole, the USSR's answer to Project MOHOL. Yes, in addition to having a space race where we went up, we had an inside race too, where we tried to go down, and the USSR beat us in that one. We've talked about this amazing feat of engineering on SciShow before, and it still holds the record for the deepest hole on Earth at just over 12 kilometers. But despite more than 2 decades of drilling, this distance is barely a fifth of the way through the continental crust, and 0.2% of the way through the Earth. The reality is, any real-world drilling effort will ultimately falter, because at some point, things will get so hot that the metal in the drills will become too soft for them to work. There are some people working on giant lasers to do this, though. So that's cool. There is a reason we know more about the furthest reaches of our solar system than we do about the inside of our planet. There's basically nothing in between us and Pluto. Like, it's just vacuum the whole way. It's the opposite when you start going down. But remember, we are suspending our disbelief here and conveniently setting aside silly little things like material physics. So let's just say we could do more than what the Soviets did. The science of seismology, which uses earthquake waves as a kind of sonar for the Earth's interior, can give us a good idea about what we might encounter. At depths of more than 3.5 kilometers, we will still find animals in the form of devil worms, which are cool as cucumbers despite the heat and pressure. Those worms eat microscopic bacteria that live down there in the rocks too, and those simple life forms can withstand even more extreme conditions, surviving more than 5 kilometers deep in the crust. Of course, all life needs water to survive, and tiny cracks from the surface can allow fresh water to permeate as deep as 10 kilometers down. But there are pockets of salty water down there too, trapped by the surrounding rock. With no way to circulate, scientists think it could have been sitting there for many millions of years and could contain ancient microbes dating from the geological past. And we'll also find ancient fossilized life here, too. All fossils were once living organisms on the Earth's surface, or they're products of living organisms. You can have fossilized poop. But over time, geological processes and plate tectonics pushed them down, deep into the crust. The Kola borehole revealed fossils of single-celled organisms 7 kilometers down, dating from 2 billion years ago. So our journey to the center of the Earth could take us on a journey back through time as well. However, the deeper we go through the continental crust, the less likely we are to find fossils. High temperatures and pressures reshape minerals to make metamorphic rocks with interlocking crystals that are some of the hardest in the world. Limestones become marble, mudstones become schists and gneisses, and in some places, the rocks themselves melt and recrystallize as huge blobs of igneous rock. And after 10 kilometers of digging, we will finally reach the mantle. The boundary between the crust and the mantle is known as the Mohorovicic discontinuity, or the MOHO for short. It's a place where seismic waves suddenly speed up as they pass into a rock of a new composition. Before we hit the MOHO, the walls of our hole would be lined with huge black crystals of gabbro, which frankly would make some absolutely delightful countertops. But the view changes once we pass into mantle rocks. Here, our drill hits peridotite, which is rich in glittery green olivine crystals with scattered red garnets like raisins in a fruit loaf. I bet you never read a geology textbook that told you that the mantle was green with red polka dots, but that's pretty much gonna be our view for the next 2,800 kilometers. Once we pass through the MOHO, we are officially in the mantle, but we're still slogging through the hard outer shell of the planet known as the lithosphere. The reason the crust and the topmost section of the mantle are grouped together is because they stick together. Even though the average temperatures are around 500 degrees Celsius, both crustal gabbro and mantle peridotite are still solid and rigid, so they behave as one. The lithosphere extends 150 kilometers beneath the oceans and 300 kilometers beneath the oldest continents. But our trip through the lithospheric mantle is far from dull, because here, scattered in amongst the green and red peridotite, we can expect to find bright flashes from a layer of diamonds. In fact, this is where most of the natural diamonds on Earth are born. Volcanic fluids are shifted around by plate tectonics, and those fluids can contain all kinds of elements, including carbon. When those carbon-rich liquids are shunted towards the bottom of the lithosphere, the high pressures and temperatures there are just right for building diamond crystals. Violent volcanic events have brought some of those diamonds to the surface, in places like Russia, Botswana, and South Africa. But there's a far bigger reservoir of gems lurking at the bottom of the lithosphere. We can enjoy a few hundred kilometers of breathtaking crystalline scenery as we travel through the lithosphere, but when the increasing temperatures hit 1300 degrees Celsius, everything changes as we enter the asthenosphere. At this temperature, it's hot enough for the mantle rocks to start behaving strangely. Now, you might be expecting to hit something like molten magma at this point. After all, we learned that it's convection of the mantle that powers the movement of the continental plates. And while the convection part is like true, I'm sorry to say that hitting the mantle isn't going to be like striking oil creating a fountain of lava. Nope, the upper mantle is a solid, but because it's so hot, it flows almost like a liquid, albeit really, really slowly. In this case, the mantle convection currents involve solid rock moving at about the same speed that your fingernails grow. So as far as we would see as we drilled down through it, the upper mantle is still that glittery green solid encrusted with garnets. Come back in 100 years though, and your hole wouldn't be where you left it. At a depth of around 410 kilometers, the behavior and composition of the mantle changes once again. Between here and a depth of 660 kilometers, we're passing through the mantle transition zone, which is marked by two changes in seismic wave speeds at the top and bottom. Scientists aren't exactly sure what's causing these shifts, but they think that it could be thanks to a huge reservoir of water trapped there. It's likely that there's about 3 times the amount of water down here as there is in all of the oceans. But before you get carried away imagining a sloshing shell of liquid down there, this is not like a subterranean ocean. Instead, this is water that is bound up inside crystals of a mineral called ringwoodite, which only forms at the precise temperatures and pressures found at these depths. So the next time you see somebody on Instagram saying, "There's a giant subterranean ocean," you can be like, "No, ringwoodite," like I do every time. The water in the ringwoodite would make these crystals bright blue. We might not be able to dip our toes in the mantle ocean, but we can enjoy 250 kilometers of beautiful blue rock as we descend nonetheless. Just don't touch it. Don't touch any of this. At the end of the mantle transition zone, ringwoodite is no longer stable, and our drill tip might begin to struggle a bit as it enters the lower mantle. Here, things are hotter still, averaging around 3,000 degrees Celsius, but the pressures of nearly 700 kilometers of overlying rock is enough to keep the mantle solid and stiff. Unlike the asthenosphere above, some geologists think that the lower mantle doesn't convect, but slowdowns in seismic waves seem to suggest that there is still some structure down there. Specifically, there are 2 massive blobs sitting opposite one another like earmuffs on the outer core, roughly under Africa and the North Pacific. And when I say massive, I mean it. Each one is twice the size of the moon. Scientists think that the seismic waves slow down here because the blobs are iron-rich, but there's some disagreement about where they might have come from. Some speculate that they are domes of extra-hot material that's rising up from the core and interacting with the colder mantle around it. But there is another more intriguing possibility, that the blobs are the remnants of a cataclysmic event in the Earth's past, like the planetary impact that created the moon about 4.5 billion years ago. That could leave chunks of very different rock buried deep in the mantle. Now, if relics of Earth's ancient history weren't enough for you, as we continue on our journey toward the bottom of the lower mantle, we find ourselves in yet another reservoir of diamonds. They form thanks to interactions at the mantle's lower boundary, as water molecules split apart and react with iron carbide. This kicks carbon out of the core, where it's forged into diamonds under extreme pressure and temperature. Since they have more than 2,800 kilometers of rock above them, most of these core mantle diamonds will never make it to the surface. But some scientists actually believe that the famous Hope Diamond may have come from the deep mantle. After drilling down for 2,890 kilometers, we have finally made it through the mantle and into the outer core. The temperature here has risen gradually to nearly 4,000 degrees Celsius at the core mantle boundary, and for the first time, our drill tip is biting into a completely new kind of material. Instead of rock, we are now drilling through metal. Specifically, an alloy of iron and nickel with some other elements such as gold, platinum, and cobalt. Because of the high temperatures, this metal mix exists in a liquid state. Its complex motion is affected by the planet's rotation, and turbulence in the outer core is responsible for generating the Earth's magnetic field, which I am a huge fan of. It's great. However, this is not something that you could go swimming in, and not just because it would sear your skin off. It's because this liquid is thick. The high pressures at this depth mean that even at the top, the molten metal is about the same consistency as peanut butter, which I have never tried to go swimming in, but don't think I would be good at. And it gets thicker, like thicker than tar, towards the bottom. So while the outer core's motion is very significant on geological timescales, we wouldn't exactly be swept away as we pass through. By the time our hole is 5,150 kilometers deep, we officially enter the inner core. Here, the temperature is around 5,500 degrees Celsius, similar to what you might find at the surface of the sun. And the pressure, which has been increasing all the way down, is now 3.6 million times that at the surface. The material we've been drilling through for the last few thousand kilometers has not changed, but despite the extra heat, the iron-nickel alloy is no longer a liquid. Instead, the intense pressure is enough to force the metal back into a solid. Curiously, the solid metal that forms under these conditions is unlike anything you would find at the surface. It exists as extremely tightly packed hexagonal iron crystals that are aligned north-south by the Earth's magnetic field. I like to imagine that it looks like a metallic version of the Giant's Causeway in Ireland, or the Devil's Tower in Wyoming. There's a little more than 1,200 kilometers of these close-packed iron crystals before we officially reach the center of the Earth. But there's one more surprise waiting for us on our way. Inside the inner core, at a depth of some 5,720 kilometers, there is an inner core, like a pit inside of a piece of fruit, which scientists have only recently discovered and still know very little about. First theorized in 2002, its existence was confirmed in 2019 thanks to seismic waves from some extremely strong earthquakes. Researchers realized that seismic waves were traveling at very different speeds depending on which direction they were going through this part of the inner core, which is thought to be thanks to another difference in crystal structure. One possibility is that the iron-nickel crystals switch to being aligned east-west instead of north-south, as if our metallic devil's tower had been turned on its side. What is less clear is why there is a 650-kilometer-thick ball of crystals on their side in the center of our planet. It could be a fossilized record of some major event in the Earth's past, but at that depth, we may never know. So here we are. After 6,371 kilometers of drilling, we have made it to the center of the Earth. We've traveled through the solid rock of the lithosphere, the solid flowing rock of the mantle, liquid metal of our outer core, and the crystalline metal of the inner and inner core. If we kept on digging now, we would just get to see it all again in reverse, with the added challenge of gravity working against us. It took the Soviets 24 years to drill through 12 kilometers of crust for the Kola Superdeep borehole. Even if we managed to match that pace despite soaring heat and pressure at 2 years per kilometer, it would take us nearly 13,000 years to make it all the way through our planet. So, if you're on the beach and serious about making the trip, you better start digging.